And by the way, the problem with the Spanish town is not that it's going to demolish 2, 3, 5 houses. It's that the new building, and it's not the problem, it's not that the new building is bigger. It's that the new building is actually uglier than the shacks. That's the problem. Okay? Because if anybody could actually love that building, that architecture, it'd be okay. It's just the St. Peter's mode. But we'll get to that tomorrow. The codes. There is a problem going on. Never, never have codes been written at such an incredible rate. It's almost impossible to keep up with the codes. It's almost impossible. Everything is metrics. Everything is measured. It used to be that only the traffic engineers measured. You know, actually needed numbers. And then the environmentalists got into numbers. And now everybody, particularly with Obama on carbon trading and transit and everything else, and you know, the federal government wants numbers. They want metrics. And everything's going to be metrics. LEED ND. LEED, the new, actually LEED building and LEED ND. It's a nightmare of actually measures and measures and measures and objective measures. I won't go into, you know, the old instinct of Jane Jacobs, or the instinct, or the system of observation, clear-eyed observation, and compelling presentation. Okay, that allowed Jane Jacobs to change the world without a single number appearing in the death and life of the great American city, or the fact that no new urbanists for the first 20 years of their existence ever had a number. We were just able to observe success and failure in a clear-eyed way and make a compelling presentation. And that's what I used to do, make compelling. Now we need numbers. It makes it incredibly more expensive. But there's something that's happening with numbers, which is as the codes are being written, like LEED ND is this thick. The new international building code that you just carelessly adopted, oh my God, that has made housing enormously more expensive. I just read the other day the rules for windows, given distances between windows. I finally understand why I needed calculus. You know, no architect has ever actually needed calculus. Except now you're going to put two buildings together, and you need to calculate on a variable system the amount of glass per square foot. There are at least three variables. It is absolutely extraordinary, and it takes a very special person. We have somebody, thank God, who grew up in a communist country and can read. Completely unbearable literature. And he's the only guy that can read the code. It's about, you know, it's like reading Marxist theory. I mean, it's amazing. But he can read it, and if it weren't for him, we would not be able to. We just sort of default to just keep everything 20 feet away, okay? And not even get into it. Because everything is lawsuit bait now. Everybody is writing documents this thick. Okay. That is a tremendous problem, and I'm going to speak about that a little bit later. But there's another problem. Nothing is coordinated. So when you come in, you know what it's like to actually work for a developer? Now, you know what an architect or a planner has to do? They have to resolve the lack of intra-governmental coordination. Okay, the codes is one thing, you know, the building codes is another, the environmentalists say a third thing, and so forth. And everything is so uncoordinated that actually it's driving places to the rural counties that don't have bureaucrats. That's really what's happening. The thing about the smart code is that it not only levels the playing field to allow, so it is no more difficult to build walkable, compact, diverse communities than it is to build suburban sprawl. It basically levels the playing field. It doesn't eliminate, by the way, suburban sprawl. It simply levels the playing field. But what it does, it takes every specialization, the traffic engineering, the public works manual, the dark sky people who do the lighting, the pavement maniacs, the moisture maniacs, the urban foresters. Everybody's a specialist now and nothing coordinates. Do you know what they teach in urban forestry school? That an oak tree requires 120 square feet to be happy. Well, that's the last oak tree you'll ever plant downtown because the planter has to be 10 by 12, which is much wider than most sidewalks. There's a complete lack, you know, of course, that's the rural ideal, but you know, the little old oak tree, and it's not unscientific, it's just the oak tree, if he wants to be downtown, has to compromise a bit with the pedestrian and the car and the building. What the smart code does is it takes the fundamental code, which is a series of elements, which you can choose, and then it has available about 20 modules. And each of those 20 modules the loose leaf binders that sit independently in the planner's bookshelf and basically integrates them in the same language. And we have been doing that, like DPZ and a group of people, really kind of brilliant, almost. These are people who would have been theologians or, you know, medieval scholars later at another time. These are the people who are writing this fundamental code, which, by the way, is freeware. We have grants for it, and it's freely available everywhere. Okay, so that's extraordinarily important, because the amount of uncoordinated paper is going to make life very, very difficult. There's going to be a backlash. All of these codes are not going to work. LEED is not going to work. You know, right now, the new LEED ND, the cost for assessing a LEED neighborhood design community came out. The fees required are higher than the design fees. Okay, so you have to pay me, and then you got to pay somebody to assess me, because it's so incredibly it's such a burden to do so. So it's all going to crash. And what I'm going to do is go straight for a smart code as soon as you can. So we do codes, we do retrofit. Now marketing. Marketing is not what it used to be. It's not what it used to be. And I see an awful lot of bad marketing. Basically, you may have noticed that the only way to sell anything, including Shell oil, is environmentalism. Okay, everybody, it is the only position. Everything is unethical. This morning there was an article about how the luxury car makers are canceling their big models. Mercedes-Benz is not talking luxury. All that used to be, the well-known, either true luxury or the aspiration to luxury. You know, the snobism, which is what we had all been conditioned to go after. You know, the free lunch. You know, how much can you get for the dollar? Whether you're a Walmart type or a 27,000 square foot house type, it was all, how much can you get, how cheaply? Gone. It is profoundly uncool. So what replaces it? We've identified and virtually confirmed that there are four environmental markets. There are four ways that you present doing the right thing. And one of them is the one that most people mistakenly use, which is to show the polar bear cub, i.e. Al Gore's presentation. You show the polar bear cub and say, look, you're hurting this incredibly lovable creature. Okay, and what that stands for, that's the ethical presentation. The ethical presentation is you do the right thing because nature is worthy. Okay, and if it costs more, and if it's not so beautiful, and if you have to go back to the outhouse or get the funny looking little car, it's the right thing to do. Okay, it's the right thing to do. That sells very little real estate. That was attempted back in the 60s, and you remember with the original granola that broke your teeth. Remember that houses, the original hippie houses had to look awful, and you could never sandpaper wood. It had to look like if you touched it, it gave you a splinter. Do you remember that? That it just crashed. You know, you cannot sell real estate on the basis of self-flagellation, you know, or penance. You can't do penance when you're trying to purchase something. Some will, but not too much. Second, okay, the second, and this is very, very, I think, is ascendant now. It's actually dominant, which is cool green. It's really cool to be green. And people, you remember two Christmases ago when you could actually purchase something by mail, you know, something very expensive, and you could checklist, you could offset the charge by buying a tree. You know, they charge you $2 and they would buy a tree in Nicaragua or someplace. You know, very cool to do that. Or people walking around with bamboo fabric shirts, you know, instead of using the old one. Or the most telling is the Prius. Do you know there was a prior Prius that was technically just as good as the new Prius? Nobody bought it. Have you ever seen what it looked like? It looked like a penance. And it's only when the second Prius came in, and normally I have a presentation to remind you, when the second Prius came in and actually looked cool, then the Prius took off. By the way, and Honda had a car that was just as good as the Prius, but it didn't look different. It didn't look cool. It was a standard Honda with all the equipment. Nobody bought it. It was discontinued.